everyone. My name is Kishantan. So this session is going to be about what are the extension points available in the carbon architecture. What are the core level extension points that are available in the carbon architecture. So to give you an overview of what I will be talking about is that I will be covering mainly three points. I'll be talking about the current carbon platform that is based on the carbon 4 version and the major extension points that are available in the carbon 4 platform. And I also will give you an introduction to the carbon 5, which is the next generation platform which we are working on, and an architectural overview of that as well. So carbon architecture, some of you may have used WSO2 products, so you may have noticed or experienced that almost all the products have the same directory structure, and you start the products using the same way that you start. For example, you use the same command to start the ESP as well as the API manager product. And if you also check the user interface, or rather the management console, that also you can see that it is also a consistent behavior across all the products. So you may wonder how we have achieved this type of consistency across all the products. So that is the underlying architecture that we have built on. So all the products that are developed at WSO2 are based on a core layer, or rather the base layer called the carbon kernel. So it is the one which provides these consistency for all the products that we develop. Apart from that consistency, the kernel also provides some core set of features that are used by all the products. For example, caching, logging, security, registry, clustering. So all sort of core features, core set of services that are provided by the kernel framework itself. So what are the product teams do is that they consume these services using the kernel framework. They develop a set of features such as known as the product level features. So we at WSO2, we don't directly develop a product. What we develop as a platform team is we develop a set of features. So after we develop a set of features, then we combine these set of features together, which is on top of this kernel framework, and then we build up a product. So not only these features can be grouped together, but you also can reuse them among other products as well. For example, the mediation feature is mainly developed by the ESP team, but the same feature is reused by the API manager product as well. So the features are not only isolated, they can also be reused across many products. So apart from the default features that are packed with a single product, you also can work on customizing the product as well. For example, let's say this is a common use case for a ESP server. So most of the users or customers, they wanted to have the data service feature also a part of ESP. They want to expose the backend database as a service also for the clients. So by default, ESP does not ship this DSS feature in the product. So how we can do this? So as I said, we develop a set of features. Once we develop, we host it in a public location known as the feature repository. So anyone can access this. So from the ESP itself, you can point to this online repository and select the DSS features and install. And then later, what you get is a new product out of it. So it is, you can call it ESP plus DSS. So likewise, any features that are available in the online repository can be installed onto any product. So that is the basic architecture of the carbon. So this is the one which I was talking about. So the bottom part is the kernel, which call as the carbon core. So it provides all the core level features such as logging, security, transport, clustering, caching, and on top of it, the product teams work on various different reusable features. And you can group these features together, which runs on top of carbon core, and call it a carbon product. That's how the basic architecture works. So I was talking about the component architecture earlier. Let's now look into how the runtime architecture would look like. So this is the typical Carbon core runtime would look like when you start a server. So the first one and the important one is the transport framework, where the messages are received and sent from clients or backend. So the transport framework itself has many transport by default it supports. For example, HTTP, servlet, transport, JMS, mail, and so likewise, there are different transport which it already supports. But it also has various extension points where you can plug in if you have your own way to process any transport or transport protocol. So after receiving this message, what you give is you have to give that to a runtime. Basically, to process after processing the message, you have to send it to a endpoint which is hosted in the server. So that is where this middle picture comes in, that is which is shown as the runtime architecture. So the first and important thing is the service, web service runtime, where we use to host all these web services that are exposed as endpoints. Likewise, there is web apps runtime and other artifacts runtime, for example, data service runtime, ESB runtime such as proxy services, sequences, REST handlers, REST APIs such as, so those type of runtimes, they get messages from the transport framework and they start to process it. But on the bottom part of the picture, you can see that there's a component mentioned as deployment engine. So the main purpose of this component is to deploy the runtime artifacts into the memory. When the server is running, now you have developed your artifact. For example, here I have developed a web app. Now we want to deploy that into the running system. So the deployment engine is responsible for deploying these type of artifacts into the runtime. So the deployment engine has set of deployers. So each deployer is associated with a runtime, which is mentioned above. So there are web app deployers, data services deployers, ESP artifacts deployers, and web service services deployer. So once the deployment engine deploys, that gets added to the runtime memory. So these are the main three components in the Carbon runtime architecture. Along with that, all these three components, they use the core services provided by the kernel. So that is the last part of this image. So core services in the sense registry, where you want to store your artifacts in the database kind of thing, and you want to provide security to your runtimes, and you want to use caching, you want to use user management and logging across all the components that you develop. So all these are core services that are provided by the kernel, and they also have their own well-defined APIs to consume. For example, for caching, we are using the JSR API to consume the caching services, but some of the other core services are exposed via the Carbon context API, which is basically is coming from the Carbon kernel itself, that are used by the other components and other products. So that's the component architecture of the Carbon. So let's look at what are the major extension points that are available in the runtime architecture of the Carbon. So I have listed only the core extension point, but there are various other extension points available, but these are the main extension points that are used by the users as well as customers. So the transport framework has its own extension points, and with the transport framework there is this another component known as the message builder and formatter, where I used to process the incoming and outgoing messages. And the next one is the handlers or valves. Handlers and valves provide some additional functionality to the incoming messages by processing the whole or part of the messages. As I explained, deployment engine also has its own extension points. Then logging, security, registry, and finally about how we can develop a Carbon component for all of these extension points. So let's look up talk about transport framework. So the main responsibility of the transport framework is to carry messages in a specific format. For example, if you take the JMS transport, it has its own transport protocol. So you have to send the message on the JMS transport. So the transport framework has two different types of entities to process JMS transport kind of messages. So it one is known as the transport receiver, other one is known as the transport sender. So transport receiver will receive messages from outside world, and transport sender will send the messages from the server to the outside world. So there are two different entities associated with the transport framework. So likewise, we are supporting all the widely used common transport protocols such as HTTP, TCP, mail, DFS, and domain-specific transports such as FIX and HL7. But we do not limit this currently supported transport. If you have your own custom transport protocol, or if you want to add a new implementation to the transport framework, you can always use the extension points available in the transport framework. You can just use the API basically and implement your own transport and plug it into the runtime. So I can give you an example where we have the ESP currently now supports this AMQP / connecting to a broker which runs on the AMQP protocol. But previous version of the ESP did not support this. So this was came from a customer as a requirement that they wanted to connect to a RabbitMQ broker to consume messages over via this transport. So we could easily achieve this with this transport framework. So likewise, if you have custom requirements, you can use the extension point available here. So the next one is the message builder and formatter framework. So this is closely related to the transport framework. So a message in a transport can come in any content type. For example, you can send JSON messages, XML messages, text messages on the HTTP transport itself. But the underlying server should identify what is this type, what is the content type, and how can I read and build a model out of it. So that is where this message builder and formatter comes into the picture. So it always associated with the transport sender and receiver. So when a message is received over a transport protocol, and based on the content type, a suitable message builder is selected, and that message builder will build that message and convert that into a common XML format that is used in the next component in the process. So when the message comes in, it passes to the transport framework, then it goes to the message builder formatter framework. So after passing the message builder formatter, the message is now in a common XML format. So that is what the underlying message model that all the products in WSOD uses. So like message builder, the message formatter is used in the other way around. That is, when you are sending the message out from the server, if the client is requesting the message in a different format, for example, you can receive the message in JSON, but you want to send that in the XML format, then you use the message formatter associated with that transport sender. This also has its own extension points. So if you have your own message type, you can have custom or legacy message type that you want to support with the ESP or any other service, you can implement the relevant extension points available in this and plug it in using the configuration. An example I can give is, so this was a customer requirement where they wanted to have a support for message type on this format, that's ISO 8583. This is normally used with ATM to bank communication, so those type of messages. But this is just the message content type, but the transport was used for TCP. Since we already had support for TCP, we only had to write a message builder and formatter to get the support of ISO 8583 message. So this is what I explained just now. So the transport is closely associated with the message builder and formatter framework. Request can come in any transport protocol, and any message content type also can come in. And after message builder build the message, the message going inside the server will be in a common XML format. Likewise, the message going out from the server, that is coming from the server, is also in XML, but you want to send the message in a different format, then use the message formatter associated with the transport sender. So the next one in the pipe is these handlers, basically. So now we have build a message. The message is now in a common XML format. Now you want to add some additional QoS functionality to this request. For example, you want to process part of this message, or you want to check whether a specific header is there. So those kind of additional things can be achieved by this handler. So you can think of handlers as interceptors which intercept the incoming message and process part or complete message of complete part of the message, and then let the message go to the next handler in the pipe. So the handlers can also be engaged both on the incoming path as well as on the outgoing path as well. So example that I can give is one of our customer. They had many web apps that deployed on the app server, WSO application server. So they wanted to have a common authentication mechanism for these web apps. So what we wrote was, we wrote a val. So you can think of val as also handler that also process incoming requests and outgoing responses. So we wrote a val which is basically supporting single sign-on to seamlessly authenticate all the web apps that are deployed in the application server, rather than embedding the authentication logic into all the web apps. We just wrote a val. So deployment engine, I think I have explained this. Various type of artifacts, you want to deploy various type of artifacts, you use the deployment engine, and there are various type of deploys associated with the deployment engine. So in here, the repository is basically the file system based repository. So the core modules, the listener from the deployment engine will basically check whether there are any new artifacts present or there are any updates to the artifact. We'll keep on checking, and once it identifies there are new changes, it will call the relevant deployer to deploy. That deployer will add that to the call the relevant runtime to deploy that into the memory. And we also have a centralized logging mechanism that is used by all the products in the WSO2, and we are using Log4j as our logging backend. But the extension points available in here is the, when you want to customize your logging appenders. Currently we have console versus console and file-based logging appender. But if you want to append to some other thing, for example, you may want to collect the logs in a centralized logging analytics server. Then you want to send those logs to those server. Then you can plug in a new appender by extending the APIs provided. Next one is the security extension. So the mostly what Carbon Core provides as security extension is the user store manager and user store listener. So user store, in the sense, you may have your own user management solution. So it can be LDAP or Active Directory or JDBC based user store, whatever. Now you want to connect that to the system, the server which is running. For example, take API Manager for example. So we already have some out of the box developed user store manager, which we can talk to AD, LDAP and RDBMS based user stores. But normally in an enterprise, they may have their own type of user stores. They may have their own schema. If it is RDBMS, they may have their own schema. So if you want to support that with the WSO2 servers, what you can use, you can extend the user store manager and plug in the different schema type so that you can call the relevant user management operation, such as adding, deleting, updating users. Then the next one is user store listeners. So these are mainly used to customize the user management activities. For example, if you are adding a user, you may want to send an email, or you may want to send a notification saying that a user was added. In that case, you can plug in a new user store listener that can capture these user management activities and notify you. Next one is the registry extensions. So each and every WSO2 products has an embedded registry in it. Registry, in the sense, you can use that as a repository to store artifacts. Repository is backed by a database typically. So that repository exposed with the registry API. So the extension points available in the registry registry or repository APIs are handlers and filters. So the handlers is the same concept that I explained previously with the request response handlers. So the only difference is that when you add a new resource, or when you try to store a new resource to the repository, before the resource is stored, it will invoke the relevant handler.
to check whether this resource can be added or not. So those kind of scenarios. An example I can give is, let's say you are trying to store a WSDL file, Web Services Description Language file, for a service. And if that WSDL file has some external references, that has to be downloaded. For example, some schema files. So if you are trying to add that, and if you have a handler written to capture this type of request and download the extensions on the fly while adding the WSDL file itself, then handlers, it's a good choice to have. So filters is closely associated with the handler, and each handler, for the handler to be executed, there should be a criteria that should be evaluated. So the criteria is provided by the filter here. For example, if this handler should be invoked for a WSDL resource. So those type of criteria can be added via these filters. So always a handler is associated with the filter. So all these extensions point that I have talked about, the best practice is to add to a running WSDL Carbon server is to develop them as Carbon components. So Carbon components are, you can think of Carbon components as OGI bundles. So OGI is the Java modular based, OGI provides the modular solution for Java based system. So we are using that concept here as well. So you can develop all these extensions as Carbon component, and we can plug it into the servers that you are using. We also have written a set of Maven archetypes to ease this process. So you can use these Maven archetypes to generate these Carbon components that can be later used in your solution. So those were the Carbon 4 and Carbon 4 extension points in the Carbon 4 architecture. Let's talk about Carbon 5, the next generation of the platform that we are currently working on. So what we have changed from Carbon 4 to Carbon 5 is that, as I said, all the underlying information, or rather the message model, is based on XML. We basically use SOAP as the XML model. So we have removed that tight dependency to the XML. So it was actually coming from the kernel itself in Carbon 4 platform. So we have removed that tight dependency. There are no more XML tight coupling to the Carbon 4 in the Carbon 5 platform. The other thing that we are mostly focusing on is that we want to reduce the memory footprint as well as the startup time. Some of the servers, you may notice that it may take 20 to 30 seconds to start up. So we want to reduce that. Currently, the kernel itself starts within a second. And the size of the kernel, as we have reduced that to 5 megabytes current. So if you talk about the features that are available in the kernel itself, it only has the minimum runtime that is needed to build a server. So you may think about the Carbon 4 kernel that has a lot of other features such as clustering, caching, security. So all these were part of the Carbon 4 kernel, but if you look at the Carbon 5 kernel, all these things are no more there. We only have the basic minimum requirement that is needed to build a server. And everything is packed within a single bundle. So earlier Carbon 4 kernel had about 15 to 20 bundles itself, bundles in the sense jar files. But when you take the Carbon 5 kernel, it has only one bundle, along with other OGI related runtime bundles. But what we develop is a single bundle now. So these are the core level of features that we provide. The important thing that you have to note is the last one, the execution multi-tenancy with containers. So we are working towards container friendliness with our products. So that's why we want to reduce the memory footprint as well as the startup time. Also earlier in Carbon 4, the multi-tenancy was within the JVM itself. That is, the multi-tenancy was in JVM. So you can create multiple tenants within the same server that will share the same resources across the same JVM, for example, memory. Now, we have completely removed that, and we are going with a container-based approach for the multi-tenancy. That's the kernel, and let's talk about the platform now. So So this is the kernel that I showed in the previous slide. And on top of the kernel, we are developing some core features, such as data sources, JNDA, caching, deployment engine, user management, and the important thing is the microservices engine. So earlier we used the SOAP as our communication mechanism, but now we are going to use, there is a in-house developed microservices engine known as the MSF4J, microservices for Java. It is basically based on REST communication model. So we will be using that as our to expose any of our APIs from the server. So all these core features along with Kaban kernel, we call it the Kaban platform. So why the name Hamming comes here is that we normally name the platform after Turing Award winners. So this is the third or fourth Turing Award winner. That's why we named it as Hamming platform. So this is the platform. And on top of this platform, product teams will start working on, actually some of them have already started working on, developing their product level features, or rather enterprise features. For example, BPMN engine, and API management, application lifecycle management, and mediation engine. So all these enterprise level features are currently, the product team will start working on it, and they will be using these core set of features that are provided by the platform. And still, we are going to use the OJ and the feature grouping concept again. So once we develop these enterprise features, we will group them together and we develop our products. So this is the overview of the Kaban, the next generation of platform that is coming up. And yeah, that's all I have for my session.